Father, we just thank you that you are a way maker this morning. You're a giant slayer, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, even when I don't see it. Come on, even when I don't feel it. Come on, God's still working. You don't have to feel it. Come on. I'm not moved by what I see. I'm not moved by what I feel. I'm moved by faith, and faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Come on, y'all. You never stop. I don't need somebody else to tell me this morning. I've got the word telling me. Come on. You're working, and even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. Never stop. You never stop working. Come on, you never stop. You never stop. You never stop working, 'cause even when I don't see it, you're working, and even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working, you never stop, you never stop working, 'cause even when I don't see it, you're working, and even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who Hallelujah. You are.
Father, that is who you are. Father, in our lives, that is who you are. Father, I thank you that depression has no hold on us, Father. I thank you depression doesn't have a hold of our kids. I thank you, Father, that you are the way maker in everything that we need, Father. Father, we just lift our hands this morning and we just thank you. Father, we come to you with a heart of thankfulness this morning. Father, we come to you with a heart of praise and of worship. We search you out. We seek you out. We do all that we can, Father, to run at your feet, Father, to just be there, Father, in your presence, Lord. As our giants stand before us, Father, as they try to distract us, Father, from who you are, Lord, we know that you are above our giants, Father. We look above them, Father. We look over the top of them, Father, and we see you standing bigger than our giants ever will, Father. If we'll just look beyond, Father, the waves, if we'll just keep our eyes on you, God, if we'll just seek you more, Father, if we'll not let the waves distract us, Father, as we continue to do the impossible, God, as we continue to walk on the water that no one said could be done, Father, as we continue to move, Father, through your presence. Father, the devil will no longer be a distraction to us, God. He'll just be an annoyance, Father, that we'll walk right by. As we focus on you, God, as we look to you, God, as we search you, seek you, Father, as we'll do everything we can, Father, to get to you. Because, God, if I could just get to you, Father, if I can just get to you, God, Father, those circumstances in our life may say that it's over. Your word, God, says you're a way maker. Your word, God, is the truth. Facts may say, Father, that things are over. Facts may say, God, that the disease is going to kill me. Facts may say that depression's got a hold on me. The facts may say something different than your word, Father, but I don't look at the facts, God. I look at the truth of your word, Father. I look at what you have for me, God. I look at what you want for me, God. I stand on your word this morning, God. And I declare freedom in my life, Father. I declare freedom for my family, God. I declare freedom for my kids. Because you are the one true God. You are the one true God who sits on the throne far above our problems, far above principalities and powers and rulers of darkness, Father. You sit far above. And God, you took me with you. You said that I am seated with you in heavenly places, Father. And if I'm seated with you, Father, then I am far above. You see, it's all about perspective. It's all about perspective this morning. If God's seated above these things and the Bible says that I'm seated with him, then I got to be above them. Come on. So, Father, we just thank you. I thank you that we are seated above, Father. That you have made a place for us, God. You loved us enough, Father, to send your son Jesus to die on a cross and Jesus, we thank you this morning. We thank you this morning. Just take a second, just thank him. Father, we just thank you. Jesus, thank you for enduring the cross. Thank you for enduring the lashes. Thank you for enduring the mocking and the beatings. Thank you for carrying that cross. Thank you for bearing our cross. Thank you for helping us and guiding us and leading us. Thank you for ultimately giving us a place in heaven. Thank you that we're not left here alone, but you sent the Holy Spirit when you went up, and the Holy Spirit came and indwells inside of us. And thank you, Holy Spirit, for helping me walk through my day and talk through my day and live through my day. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being with me and not leaving me. You do answer my prayers, Father. And simply because you love me. Not because of anything that I did or anything that I could ever do, Father, but you made a way simply because you love me. Do you understand that this morning, that he made a way simply because he loves you? He didn't require anything from you except for you to come to him. That's all he required, was to come. And he said, if you would just come to me and bow at my feet and just worship me, if you would just accept me into your heart, if you would just, everybody would just bow your head and just close your eyes. Nobody looking around this morning. This is personal right here. If you're dealing with depression, would you raise your hand? Come on, don't be afraid. Come on. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, if you're dealing with that depression, thank you. If you're dealing with the devil pulling you back, come on. Don't be scared to raise your hand. God's got something for you this morning. Father, you see the hearts and you see the hands, Father. And Lord, we speak right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you that you are greater than the depression that is pulling on these people, Father, that you are the giant slayer, Father, that the depression is simply a giant that is distracting us from your goodness. So, Father, take that depression in the name of Jesus. Father, we cast it aside, that spirit of depression. We cast it aside in the name of Jesus, that their eyes may be opened, that they may know the hope and the calling that you have called them to, Lord. That your goodness resides in their life, Father. This depression is gone in the name of Jesus, that we can keep our eyes, Father, on you. Devil, take your depression and leave in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for freeing us, for healing us, Father. Father, we just come before you this morning, and we seek you, we search you, Father. We look to you, Lord, this morning, because you are a good God. Thank you, Father, for who you are and for what you're doing, Lord. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Hey, before you guys are seated, yeah, come on. Hey, before you guys are seated, I want you to do something. Usually we're like shaking hands next to us, but let's just find some people in this room that maybe we don't know and just go say hi. Let's take 60 seconds and just go greet everybody this morning.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So I tell you what, I love the sound of fellowship. Come on, I love just greeting everybody and just hallelujah. Well, if this is your first time here, maybe you haven't been in a while, my name is Pastor Adam, and I'm one of the pastors on staff here at Connect, and I have the honor today of bringing you the Word of God. And I tell you what, when God's moving like that, sometimes it's hard to get out of it. You know what I mean? I mean, I enjoy worshiping God. I enjoy just getting in His presence. But I'll say this every time, because you need to know it. As good as worship is, we need the Word. Come on, because without the Word, we can't really worship. Because without the Word, we can't really grow our faith. Because our faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. And if I'm not digging into the Word of God, then I'm not growing my faith. And if I'm not growing my faith, can I truly worship? It's a full circle all the way back around. And so we're going to get in the Word this morning. But I just want to tell you, thank you for coming this morning. Like if you're looking for a home church, like if you're here visiting, welcome home. Come on, y'all. Amen. Welcome home. Is that all y'all got? Come on. So one thing I do want to mention to you guys this morning is that in 2 weeks, it's kind of a big event coming up, kind of a big time for the church, the big C and the little C, however you want to look at it. Come on, we got Easter in 2 weeks, y'all. Come on, y'all, come on. So what we've made available for you guys is you'll see these in your seat. It is an invite card for you guys to invite people to Connect Church for Easter. And so here's my look at this. Because in times past, I have been like, I don't want to impose upon people. You know what I mean? Like sometimes you're scared to ask people to come to church, like what's going to happen, and, you know, are they going to say no? But, you know, the way that I view this card is that it's not for me. Because if I always leaned on what I felt, I never would invite anybody. This card is for the person that you're giving it to. You have friends that need to hear the gospel. You have friends that need you to invite them. You know, there's a couple times a year that people will inevitably say yes. One of those is Easter. Because they understand that there's something big that goes on. It's an event that we celebrate. It's the time that we celebrate Jesus coming out of the tomb. And so I'm just going to ask that you take as many of these cards as you want. We'll have them this week. We'll have them next week. We also, on Facebook, we have the same invite that you can send out on your Facebook and let people know, because I'm telling you, people need the gospel. And if you are a Christian sitting in this place, this isn't about you. You've got a place. Come on, y'all. I know I'm going to heaven. But I got some friends that I'm not real sure about that I want to give an invite to. Or I've got people that I know that are going through things that, man, if I could just get them here into the worship of God and get some word in them, I know that they would. Come on, y'all. So take some invites with you. If there's not enough in the seats, we've got them in the back. We've got them out there at the Connect spot. I think there's some at the children's spot. So invite people to Easter. Amen? Amen. So we are on this series of a savage Christian. We're on this series of looking into a Christian that is all in. Someone that won't be stopped by what the devil says. Somebody that won't look away from what God has for them, but will keep their eyes upon them. You know, Peter, we referenced a little bit earlier, but Peter walked on water. Peter did something that nobody else did. And I look at that and I'm like, man, I wouldn't want to do that. Come on. like he was so focused on God. And then he lost focus. You know, I don't know about you guys, but there's been times in my life I've lost focus. There's been times when I have focused on the wrong thing. There's been times when I have been unfocused. You know, 2020, I feel like, was a year that we all got unfocused. You know, we all thought, man, this is the year. It's 2020, right? Vision, right? Come on, we got 2020 vision. And then literally all hell broke loose. And I feel like we lost our vision in 2020 because we're all running around trying to figure out what to do during a pandemic. I know as a pastor, I was running around trying to figure out how to pastor during a pandemic. Like, they wouldn't let you in the hospitals to see people. They wouldn't, come on, people didn't want you in their houses trying to figure this thing out during this time. And I feel like focus was lost or maybe blurred just a little bit. But 2021 is going to be a year that we refocus. 2021 is going to be a year that we go deeper with God. You know, we talked about James last week. We were in the book of James. And for those of you that don't realize, the book of James was written. He wasn't written by the disciple James. It was written by the half-brother of Jesus. Someone that grew up with Jesus. It was written by him. And a lot of people will reference this because this is known to be one of the oldest books that was written in the New Testament. See, a lot of times we want to put them in order that they're in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and it's not necessarily that way. James was one of the first books that was written. And it was written at a time, and I want you to understand this, that it was written at a time when Christians were being persecuted. See, it was written to the Jewish Christian, which was even being persecuted even more than just being a Jew at the time. If you were a Jewish Christian, if you had accepted Jesus, the persecution was even greater. So people were losing their jobs, they were losing their houses, they were being killed, they were being pushed out of their city at this time simply because of their belief in Jesus. And so James starts his book by saying to everybody that's been dispersed, to everybody that's out there, and I almost see it as, a call, if you will, of, I just want to let everybody that I can't see, everybody that's been pushed out, displaced, everybody that's not at home anymore, that there is a hope that you are carrying with you. You see, James wanted people to understand that it wasn't just hearing, and this is kind of the central theme of James, is that it wasn't just hearing the word, but there was something we needed to do. There were some actions that needed to be taken to show our faith. And so in reading James, in understanding the book of James, you need to understand where the church was, because the church was being killed. The church was being persecuted. The church was having to find new homes in other places because they were being pushed out of their current home. And so when in James chapter 1 and verse 2, when it says, "Consider it completely joy, my brethren, whenever you are enveloped or encounter trials or any sorts or fall into various temptations," he said, "consider that joyful." Now, if I'm being persecuted and pushed out or even killed, and James is saying, listen, you're carrying a hope with you into a world that needs it. You may be displaced and pushed out from your home, but there's something you have that other people need. And so he wants them to know that the hope and the calling that is inside of them is something that everyone else needs. And so when he says, consider it all joy, come on, what he's saying is it's not joy. Like, there's no joy in being persecuted. There's no joy in being killed. There's no joy in being pushed out of my home and losing my job and family members. There's no joy in that. But James says, listen, you need to consider this joy. Meaning that it may never be a joyful time in your life. It may never be a time that is joyful when we run into this persecution and these tests and these trials. It may never be, but I need you to consider it joyful. Like, I need you to step out in faith and understand that God has something for you. You know, over in Luke chapter 5, this is where we see the calling of some disciples into the ministry. But there's some things in Luke chapter 5 that I think are very critical to where we're at as a church and what God's asking us to do as a church. So open your Bibles. Let's go to Luke chapter 5 this morning. Get out your smartphones, get your Bible apps out, get your notes app. Let's take some notes this morning. So I just want to read through this, and then we'll come back and we'll go over it, because in Luke chapter 5, we're going to start in verse 1. It says, on one occasion, while the crowd was pressing into him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake. And he saw two boats by the lake, and the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. And getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, which is Peter, he said to him, to put out a little bit from the land. And he sat down and he taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, Master, man, we struggled all night long and we didn't catch anything. He said, but at your word, I will let down my nets. And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking, and they signaled for their partners in the other boat, like, come on, we need some help. And they came and they filled the boats, and so they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. So during this time of this scripture, Jesus is coming, and there's this crowd around him that are just kind of pushing him along. And they're making their way down the shoreline. And Jesus comes upon this boat, and the fishermen that are not in their boat, they're next to the water. They're washing their nets because they've fished all night long and didn't catch anything. And so I think about this because, you know, Peter, he was a fisherman. That was his life. That's what he did. Like, he grew up. Every fiber of his being was fishing. That's how he made his living. Yet that night, he didn't catch anything. See, a lot of times in our life, we look at our circumstances and say, my life's not going right because this circumstance didn't happen. Like, I've worked all that I could, and I still didn't get a paycheck this week. I still didn't get my bonus. I still couldn't do anything. I've worked at my marriage, and I've tried. I've been to counseling. We've done everything we can, but our marriage still isn't happening. And sometimes we're on the side, and we're washing our nets because we've had enough for that day. Like, I'm done fishing. You understand? This is it. And then here comes this man named Jesus walking down the shoreline. He's like, hey, Peter, hey, can I use your boat? Peter's like, yeah, that's fine. He said, hey, push away from the shoreline just a little bit so I can kind of let the waters kind of carry my voice to the people. So they pushed off into the shallow, and Jesus taught them. Now, something I want you to understand at this point is that what Jesus was teaching, Peter was hearing. See, a lot of times we overlook the point that at some point Peter needed to hear what Jesus had to say, and this was it. This was the point when Peter is sitting in a boat listening to a man who is the Messiah. And he's sitting there and he's listening to what he has to say, and something raises up inside of him. And Jesus said, okay, so we've pushed out just a little bit here. Jesus said, but I need you to go a little deeper. Come on, y'all. I need you to push out from the shore just a little bit more, and let's go a little deeper. Let's go to where something that I don't know what's going to happen. You see, Jesus asked him to push out into the deep and to lower his nets, but Peter's sitting there going, I just fished all night. like every fiber of being of what I understand to happen, this is wrong. Like, this is not the time to fish. I'm washing my nets. I've given up. Jesus said, I just need you to go a little deeper. I need you to push out from the shore just a little more. You see, we're not quite deep enough yet. You see, we can still touch the bottom and head be above. You see, we can still stand and not drown. But I need you to go a little deeper with me. I need you to push out from the shore just a little more, because there's a place out there that I've prepared for you. And Peter goes, Lord, we have fished all night with catching nothing. But because you say so. Come on, the teaching that he just got in the boat was transitioned into doing something. You see, the teaching that Jesus had just gave him in the shallow, see, everybody wants to be taught in the shallow. Everybody's okay with just dipping their feet in a little bit. Everybody's okay with just give me the word enough. But when God says to go out deeper, come on, and God says, I've got something for you in the deep, a lot of us are like, I want to stay on the shore. But Peter was like, we're going to push out just a little more. So he pushes to the deep water. The place that he can't stand, the place that he can't see the bottom, the place that he doesn't understand. And in a situation that every fiber of being of my natural self says, this is not right because of my knowledge. But you see, Jesus has knowledge well beyond what we have. Jesus has knowledge in things that we don't even understand. His teaching and his understanding is so much deeper than ours. And sometimes it just takes a step of faith. A step of faith, because not only did Peter push out and went deeper, now he had to do something else. Come on, he could have been out in the boat and he could have sat in the boat all day long. But until he threw his net overboard, wasn't anything going to happen. You see, God needs you to take a step of faith sometimes that doesn't necessarily compute in the natural. God needs you to step out and push out and do something that, you know what, that doesn't quite make sense, God. You want me to start a business because why? We're still in a pandemic. Why would my business work? God said, push out a little deeper. Let's go a little deeper than we've ever done before. You see, Peter's blessing was in his obedience. Our blessing in our life is in the obedience that we're willing to give. God can bless us to the point that we're willing to push out. God will say, as deep as you want to go, I'll take you there. He said, but it's up to you how far you want to push out, and it's up to you if you want to throw your net over. But if you will, I've got a load for you. I've got a haul for you. I've got more fish for you than your boat can handle. Matter of fact, you're going to have to call other people in to come help you with that, because you can't comprehend or handle what I have for you. So Jesus was sitting in that boat and asked Peter to drop his net. And the only reason he did it was because Jesus asked him to. So what is Jesus asking you to do? Come on, what nets are you supposed to be dropping overboard? What things are you supposed to be searching out? But you need to understand that the faith that Peter had inside of him came from the teaching earlier. See, a lot of times we want to step out, but we don't have enough word. Come on, y'all. Like we don't have enough word. Like, we don't, what is something that I say? If you come up to me and you ask for prayer, I'm going to ask you what? What scriptures you standing on? Why? Because the word is the only thing that's going to take you and going to bless you. That's it. What scriptures are you standing on? What scriptures have you found that pertain to your situation? What scriptures are you growing your faith with? A lot of us want to stay on the shore. A lot of us don't want to go deeper with God. Because when I go deeper with God, inevitably He's going to ask me to do something. Come on, He's going to ask me to do something. You know, Farrah and I, we've learned through the years that, man, when God says something, we're just going to do it. Like we've purposed in our hearts. And so we were pastoring a church in Arkansas. And I was working. I was doing construction. We had went to Bible college. We'd graduated Bible college. We'd came back. We were pastoring a small church there in Arkansas that actually kind of helped us get through Bible college. We were kind of giving back to that church. But I had went back to doing construction. I'd went back to building houses. And one of Ferris' things was, we can go back home to Arkansas, but I don't want to go back to what we were doing before. And so we go back, and I was building houses for the same guy when I left. And when we came back, I went back to building houses for the same guy. But there was a purpose in this that I didn't see, nor did she see. Because while we were in Bible college, I'd actually started working for a bank. And I was a personal banker. And man, I would go to school the first half of the day from 8 to noon. I'd get off at noon. I'd go to work from 1 to 9. The bank closed at 9. Then we'd close the bank down. I'd get home about 10:30, 11. Then I would do my schoolwork. And so I'd go to bed about 3 in the morning. And Farrah was like, I don't want to go back to what we were doing before. You ever step out into something and then you go back and you're like, man, nothing changed. I either didn't learn what I was supposed to learn or something, but I'm back doing what I was doing before. But there's a purpose in that position. And so I'm at a men's conference. We'd taken some guys from our church to a men's conference. And I'm sitting there in this men's conference, and I know exactly where I'm sitting, and I can take you to the exact place that my chair was at. And I'm sitting in this seat, and the speaker's talking, and I can't tell you what he was talking about, because God, as I'm writing my notes, and this is why I think it's so important to take notes, because as you're writing things down, God's going to start talking to you, and you're going to keep writing. And so I'm taking notes, and on the top left part of my paper, I'm writing notes, and I hear the Spirit of God inside, and He says, quit your job, go to Bank of America. So I write that down, quit your job, go to Bank of America. I wrote it out as a slant, the top left-hand corner of my paper. So I'm going back, and I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking, so here's my natural thought. Come on, y'all. I'll go to Bank of America because I'd already been there before when we got home and they had a hiring freeze on nationwide. They weren't hiring anybody. So my initial thought was, I'll go to Bank of America, and if they don't have anything, I'll just go back to building houses. And as soon as that thought rolled through my head, God said, look at the order I told you to do it in. You see, God has an order to things, and that order sometimes takes you to push out a little deeper. And so the order said to quit your job and then go to Bank of America. Okay. So we get home. It's Sunday afternoon. I go to my boss's office. His office was at his house out in another building, and I knew he would be out there. And so I walk in his office, and I stand at the door. I don't even go all the way in. Like, I just open the door up, right? And I just, like, stand at the door frame. And I said, Larry, I said, I've got some other things on my heart that I feel like I'm supposed to do, so I'm not gonna come back. And he looks at me and he goes, Adam, he goes, hey, if whatever you're doing doesn't work out, just come on back. He said, you'll always have a job with me. That was my point. That was when I had to make a decision. That's when I had to let the boldness inside of me step up and say, I said, Larry, I said, I appreciate the offer, but I won't be back. He said, okay. He wasn't saved at that time. But I know for a fact that Larry got saved before he passed away. And at that time, Larry was probably in his 60s already. So I left there Monday morning. I went to Bank of America. Job's waiting on me, right? Walk in the door, go sit down, talk to Angela, because I'd already talked to her before about it. I said, hey, I just wanted to come back in. I just wanted to let you know that, you know, I'll see if you guys are hiring. She goes, nope. Hiring freeze is still on. Okay. I've quit my job and I don't have another one. And I have a family to support. I had two kids at the time and a wife. So I did what every red-blooded Arkansan would do. I went deer hunting. It was November. It was deer season. I enjoy deer hunting. I'm going to go deer hunting. Didn't see a thing, but I got to fellowship with God. So I left there. I went deer hunting that afternoon. Went deer hunting Tuesday, Wednesday. Went deer hunting Thursday morning. Still didn't see anything. But Thursday afternoon, I got a call. Hiring freeze was still on. They were still not hiring nationwide. But they called me and Angela goes, hey, can you come in tomorrow? Said, we would like to hire you for this particular position, which is the one I wanted. At this particular location, which is the location I wanted. And so I get there and I'm like, next day I'm like, I was like, let me check my calendar, right? Like, I still had deer hunting to do. But I, you know, it's okay. So I go the next day, walk in, do all of our paperwork, and I asked her, I said, is there still a hiring freeze on or did it come off? She goes, no. She goes, the hiring freeze is still on. She said, but we had to fire somebody yesterday. She said, you were the top candidate that we had for this position, and we have to fill this position. We can't go without it. God knew what was going to happen, and it was well beyond my natural thinking. I had to push out in the deeper just a little bit more, and I had to push back from the shoreline where I knew I couldn't touch the deep anymore, like it was well below where I was at. And I had to understand that God had me regardless. And so that's what I did. And because I did that, God had a position for me. Now, I'm not saying that the person got fired simply because I did what I did, but I'm saying that God knew what was going to happen. And had I not have stepped up and went down there on Monday and told them, hey, I'm still available. Like, I don't have a job anywhere else at any other banks right now. Matter of fact, I don't even have a job right now. I didn't tell them that, but you know what I mean. But had I not have done that, there may have been somebody else that they called. Had I not took the step of faith and pushed that a little further from the bank. So I just want to encourage you today. Whatever God's asking you to do, wherever he's telling you to push away and to go into the deeper, go with him. Go with him and don't just sit in the boat. Throw the nets over. Throw the net over the side and pull in what God's got for you. Amen? You guys pray with me. Father, I just thank you this morning. Father, I thank you for who you are and what you're doing. Father, I thank you that 2021 is going to be a year of going deeper with you. Father, I don't know what you're asking each person to do. I don't know what the deep water is looks like to them, Father, but I know that you have prepared for us a blessing that lies in our obedience. And Father, I thank you for that. Lord, as we step out and we step back and we push away from the shore, Father, and we realize that we're in a situation that only you can handle, Father, I thank you that you've given us the faith to push through the circumstance, Father. And even when it doesn't seem like it's joyful, Father, I thank you that we're going to count that as joy. Because joy is a choice, Father, that we make. Father, I ask blessings upon each person, Father, that hears this message. That they would push out into the deep. And that they would do what you've called them to do, Father. That a boldness would raise up inside of them, Father. Father, you're amazing, God. And Father, I thank you so much for what you're doing. More of you, Father, and less of us. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, I just want to give an opportunity real quick for anyone that's in here that maybe you need to come back to Jesus. Maybe you've been walking away from him for a while, or maybe you've never accepted Jesus. I want to give you that opportunity. I want to give you the opportunity to meet the Jesus that I know. So if you're in this place today, we're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to have you come up front, but I would love to know who I'm praying for this morning. So if you're in here this morning and you say, I've been away from Jesus and I want to come back, or I've never even met him, but I would love to know this God that you're talking about. If that's you this morning, can you just raise your hand so I know who I'm praying for? Is there anyone in here this morning? Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Well, looks like we're all saved this morning. Come on. Come on. There's nothing better knowing that we have a place in heaven, regardless of the circumstances that we're going through. Amen. Well, I just want to change gears real quick before we leave, before we send you guys out into the mission field of the world to share the gospel. I just want to take a moment just to take up our offering. So if you need an offering envelope this morning, just raise your hand. The ushers will have the offering envelope. They can get to you. If you're giving by cash, just raise your hand this morning. We have several ways that you can give to Connect Church. One of those ways is through Venmo at Connect Church of Abilene. You can also go to our website and you can give online, connectchurchofabilene.com. So you can also put it in the bucket. We're not necessarily going to pass the buckets this morning, but our ushers will be in the back this morning, and you can just drop it off when you go by there. But just know that you're not giving just to a church, that you're giving through us. That we have food banks and we have different organizations that we support to help get the gospel out. Not just through us. We're not the only one. Come on. We want to support everybody that's preaching the gospel that we can. We can't do everything, but we can do something. Amen? So you guys stand with me this morning. Come on, I've had to stand the whole time. You guys stretch out a little bit this morning. So before we leave, we have a confession that we say, and I hope that this last part, I hope that you guys have taken this and say it in your own lives, because this is something I say over myself, over my kids, over my family on a daily basis. This is all scriptural. So you guys say this with me this morning. As I give my tithes and offerings, I confess God is first in my life. I give with a cheerful heart because I love God. In 2021, I am healed, whole, healthy, blessed, and prosperous in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, we love you guys. Hey, don't forget, grab some of the invites for Easter. Also, we need more plastic eggs and candy so we're going to have a festival at the time for Easter for all the kids, because we don't have a place we can necessarily do like a, you know, an egg hunt. So we're going to have a festival at that time, have food trucks, free food for people and everything. So you guys spread the word about the gospel for Easter. We love you guys. Y'all have a blessed week.